All right. Does everybody have their Yeats's poetry, drama, and prose? Everyone have a copy or sitting next to someone that has a copy? Okay, Katie, very good. Because we are going to look at it. Not all of the poems. There were a lot of poems. And I understand, you know, 40 pages of poems, that's a lot to go on. Certainly there's a lot to do in this time period. There's a lot of things happening in Ireland and in England. Though we're in modern British Lit, and I'm really not going to talk about Britain at all. But that's okay. We're going to gloss over that fact by saying that Ireland was kind of a colony of Britain, from what I understand, so that counts. So here, like my last presentation, I liked starting off with a quote. This is a quote from John O'Leary, who I have here. It was an Irish patriot who was exiled from Ireland, and I believe he came back. But at some point in his young adulthood, Yeats met O'Leary, and he kind of took this quote to heart for the part of his career that I'm looking at, and I'm sure for the rest of his career as well. So the quote is, "There is no great literature without nationality, no great nationality without literature." And as Americans, we can understand that, you know, literature is a big part of our nationality. You know, the founding fathers, they didn't just say it, they wrote it down and they transmitted it throughout the country. And everybody knows that that was a really big deal, to have the spoken word in writing to be, you know, disseminated around the people, to spread the ideas. And so that was also a big deal in the kind of quest for Irish nationalism as well. But as I found out in doing my research, it was done kind of in a backwards way, and so I found that interesting. I'll talk about that a little bit later. And as I said, you know, this is a really broad topic. It's a really, you know, 40 pages of poems is a lot of poems to read. The Irish Literary Revival is a pretty big deal. So I'm going to narrow it down as best I can using the things that interested me. This is my presentation. So the pretty narrow overview here is I'm going to talk about Yeats. I'm not really going to talk much about his background, because it's not what really matters to me as much. He will do all of that after I give my presentation. So I really just want to talk about what he does with these works that I'm going to study. And then I didn't, of course, can't talk about every single one that we had to read. So I picked out a few, and I'm going to talk, we're going to listen, you know, you're going to talk, I'm going to listen. It's going to be fantastic. So the narrow subject is the poems that I really want to focus on, for the most part, are the ones that talk about mythology. Everybody knows that's his thing. Everybody who knows about Yeats knows that that's what's associated with his name, for the most part, especially these early works that we're looking at, these early poems in particular. You know, according to, I have one of my authors here in one of these little books that says that Yeats was the first person to really do this in Ireland. You know, other cultures pull from their mythology as part of their political agenda, and that makes it more relatable for the common people who know the myths like they know their own stories. But Yeats was the first person in this time in Ireland to really pull from this ancient mythology and bring it to the forefront and relate the problems of now to the problems of then. And that's really what I want to focus on here today. So I have a quote from this really great book that Dr. Moore let me borrow, called Inventing Ireland, which, I mean, it really does say, you know, how this new Ireland was invented. So this beginning of the chapter about Yeats himself says, at the outset, the aspiring young poet W.B. Yeats was sure that a literary career of any worth would only be possible in London. Ireland for him would be an imaginary homeland, the sort of place endlessly invented and reinvented by exiles who fear that if they do not give it a local habitation in words, it may entirely disappear. And that is just what Yeats did during that early part when he was growing up in London and trying to wrangle out a literary career from this time of political, social turmoil, is that he gave Ireland a home in the poems that he wrote that we're going to look at. And it says, Yeats may eventually have returned to Ireland, like so many exiles before and since, simply to make sure that it was still there. So we're going to look at a few of the poems that he wrote and talk about what his goal was for Ireland, and talk a little bit about the colonization, bring it back to Katie's presentation of last week. So I have some notes here that I've pulled saying, the Irish literary revival emerged out of a void created by colonial subjugation. famines decimated the population, and that's kind of mid-19th century, I believe, leaving Ireland weakened and without a culture of its own. The tradition of a strong, rugged Irishman seemed like a thing of the past, reduced to myths and legends. What was once a unique and thriving culture seemed forgotten by a colonized people who were just struggling to survive. Writers like Yeats and his contemporaries aimed to remind them. Thus, the cultural renaissance of Ireland was born. So now, when you think of Irish mythology, and many of you may not know the specifics, like I did not until I started reading some of this for other classes, but when you think of that Irishman, that rugged Irishman, maybe some of you think of a leprechaun, but just ignore that stereotype, please, God's sake. What do you think? Somebody give me a word that pops into your head. What do you think when you think of that Irish spirit? Katie.
Probably their accent.
Okay.
The way that they talk.
Is it unique? Is that what you're going? It's unique to the people. Okay. Luke, what do you think when you think of that typical Irishman?
Typical.
Okay. Yes, definitely. All right, Daniel, what do you think? Comes into your head first thing.
I think of the potato famine in House. Since they bounce back from that, they must be kind of strong.
Okay, strong. See, those are good words. A cult, strong, unique. Courtney, what do you think? What do you think of Ireland? What do you think?
Beer.
You think beer?
Sorry.
Okay, you think lighthearted, you think spirited, you think fun-loving. Well, all of those things, those are what Ireland wasn't. All those things that you think, that they weren't that. They were, you know, just trying to live. They could barely keep hold of the land that they were standing on at this point. You know, they were... Really, I mean, I do not know. I'm not going to pretend that I know a ton about the history of England colonizing Ireland and kind of keeping that stranglehold on them for years and years. But, I mean, what we all know from classes in literature is that they did. I mean, England spit out a culture and Ireland had to kind of suck it up because that was what they could get, you know. It was a cultural desert over there from once a land that once was so rich and powerful in its identity became just nothing. This point. And I hate to say that, but I mean, that's kind of what happens when you're colonized. And we know, I had a great quote, let's see if I can find it, about colonization. It was saying that just from history that, here we go. Cultural colonies are much more susceptible to the literature of the parent country than are the inhabitants of the country itself. So they're saying colonized people soon comes to believe that approved fictions are to be imitated in life. And breaking that down is saying that the culture that England kind of just threw out over there, Ireland was much more susceptible to those ideals than even the people in England themselves. So that void that they had kind of pulled over from England's culture. And some of it I'm sure was on purpose, as you know, we know from Katie's presentation, to kind of push your ideals onto your colonized country is a facet of colonization itself. I heard there's an interesting anecdote in here that says that an Irishman was put on trial, and he, even though he spoke the natural language of Ireland, he wanted to defend himself in English, even though the judge offered to do, you know, hold the proceedings in his own language. He wanted to defend himself in a language that he barely understood and barely could speak, just because he was ashamed of what Ireland had become, basically. And I mean, that says a lot about, you know, the literature and the art of the time as well. So, and now we're going to go back to Yeats. They're talking about the ideal of a national poet like Yeats or like Walt Whitman. It says that the ideal is to displace this constricting environment and its accompanying forms. Since freedom cannot be won in them, it must be won from them. And so Yeats set out to write works that would encourage Ireland to become what his ideal Ireland is. And so we're going to kind of talk about what his ideal Ireland is. So I said that many of Yeats' early works feature mythological figures and also have a particular focus on the natural aspects and the nature of Ireland. So in a time where land was nothing more than a commodity to exploit or to be exploited, and I put a little note in here to discuss the land war and the land courts and all of that. I mean, but everybody pretty much knows what all that was, right? Does anyone know what the land wars and the land courts were in Ireland at the time? Yes? No? We can talk about it? Okay. From anybody who's read A Modest Proposal by Swift, they understand, you know, that part where he talks about the landlords eating the children because they were so accustomed to eating the parents already, you know, it would be second nature to eat a baby belonging to one of their tenants. I mean, that's that idea that they're showing, is that the land in Ireland, especially in places like Dublin, it was, things were getting rough. People couldn't hold on to their land. Their rents were skyrocketing. The people who, the landlords were kind of holding a stranglehold on people. You know, you had to have somewhere to live. The money, you could make money by living in the city, but trying to find a place to live was a huge hassle and it was very unfair. So there were actual, you know, they call it the land war from 1879 to 82. And then in 1903 emerged the rule of these land courts that went around and tried to regulate how much the rent could be. And it did some good and it did some harm, depending on, you know, the landlords, like Lady Gregory, Yeats's very good friend. She had an estate. She was one of those Anglo-Irish people that were landholders, and she ran her estates pretty fairly, according to Yeats. And she was also kind of attacked by these land courts trying to get her rent even lower. And so, I mean, it was, there, you know, it was a big deal, this land. So I said that the land was more than a commodity to exploit or be exploited on. Through some of these poems, Yeats reminds his readers that the land does not belong to them, but to a host of legendary beings and their stories. So if you guys could open up your Yeats poetry to, let's see, I think it was 23. Yes, to the poem, The Hosting of the She. And if you see down in the footnote, she was kind of a ruling entity from what I see. They were talking about, let's see, she is also Gaelic for wind. They are the ancient gods of Ireland, basically. So, would anyone like to read it out loud? Anyone like to read some of it out loud? Anyone? All right, I guess I will read it out loud, guys. The host is riding from Knocknarea, and over the grave of Cluth na Bear, Cult tossing his burning hair, and Niam calling, away, come away. Empty your heart of its mortal dream. The winds awaken, the leaves whirl round. Our cheeks are pale, our hair is unbound. Our breasts are heaving, our eyes are agleam. Our arms are waving, our lips are apart. And if any gaze on our rushing band, we come between him and the deed of his hand. We come between him and the hope of his heart. The host is rushing twixt night and day. And where is there hope or deed as fair? Cult tossing his burning hair, and Niam him calling, away, come away. So, despite my horrendous pronunciation of some of these things, you can see how he's describing the land and the inhabitants of the land. You know, he's saying that this, from Knocknarea, which, from what I am seeing, is a place, he's saying it's not just an area, it's the grave of Cluth na Bear. Knocknarea is a mountain. It's the burial site of Queen Maeve of the Sidhe, and then Cluth na Bear is a person, and he died in this place. But what I'm getting at here, not to muddle things too much, is that he is giving the places a mythology. He's assigning a legend to a particular location. So I think, in my opinion, what he's doing is he's trying to revive the land by connecting it to stories, and he's trying to revive the stories by, you know, writing it down and giving it life, personifying these entities that may have been forgotten, you know, in this race just to live, just to survive, just to have a place to lay your head at night, you know. So he's, through this poem, you know, you feel like, you know, you're standing on a cliff and you feel the wind in your large red beard, and, you know, the wind is chilling the beer in your hand, and, you know, you know, but if you're reading this poem, and if you're Irish, and if you're poor, and if you're downtrodden, you know, there's something about this that says, okay, well, the land was here for them, the land can be here for me. Especially after a long period of time where, you know, you really can't trust the land, like the potato famine, everybody knows what that was. You get to a point where you lived from the land, and the land lived with you, and everything was one with nature, and then all of a sudden, you have nothing to eat. And that's gotta be very hard to trust that the land is going to be there for you. And I think that's a big reason why so many people flocked to these cities and suffered under these gouging landlords, because they, you know, at least the city, there was some sort of safety net, though not, I mean, it had really large holes in it, big enough for even a leprechaun to slide through. So that's what I'm going with here, is that his real push to show that the land is a part of us, just like it was a part of the lives of these mythological beings. So that was that point there. And then I put, because that's, I mean, the point that I'm really trying to make here, I'm saying that Yeats' descriptions of Ireland's past show his dreams for Ireland's present. I use the word strong and rugged. I mean, I use these terms a lot to describe this kind of past Ireland. And I believe what Yeats is trying to do by bringing all this back up again is not dwelling in the past and saying, oh, things were great, we need to make Ireland great again. No, he's saying that we were this, but we could be this, you know, this strength, this rugged, you know, like America, that was it, a rugged individualism or something like that. That could be us again. And so, let's see, I think I use all these exact words again. The Ireland of Yeats' poetry is rugged, tough, strong, battle-worn, but thriving. Her stories and traditions are memorialized in Yeats' work. And I put, you know, my point here is that it serves as a blueprint for the people of Ireland who are struggling to form an identity of their own. He writes to Ireland, about Ireland, and for Ireland in an attempt to create a new Ireland that emulates the old. His poems can be seen as a recipe for his ideal Ireland. So, let's see. And to go back to that literary revival, I have that in here somewhere. The writers of Young Ireland, as they called themselves, one of their things that they were working on was to create a national image for Ireland and a distinctive essence of Irishness. So this time they didn't have an Irishness. They were just people, maybe British people, maybe hungry people, maybe sad people. You know, they weren't Irish people. And let's see. I have a good quote from myself here that says he drew upon themes from when Ireland was stronger in order to infuse modern Ireland with this strength. So if we, I mean, any of the poems that we read, they show people. And a lot, these, it's hard to kind of get the true feeling of Irish mythology from these poems because a lot of these references you're not going to understand. You're going to be reading little footnotes that are using names you can't pronounce. But if you really looked at Irish mythology, it's a lot about, you know, war and triumph and hard times and coming back and believing in the land and believing in yourselves and your gods working with you or against you. But, I mean, it's a lot like Greek mythology in that sense where they give that, really infuse it with that sense of courage and strength. So, let's see. So if we want to turn again to our poems, I have a poem here, Red Hanrahan's Song About Ireland. And you can really see how he feels about the people and the land in this. And I guess I'll read it out loud again at risk of butchering the pronunciations once more. So the old brown thorn trees break in two high over Cumann Strand under a bitter black wind that blows from the left hand. Our courage breaks like an old tree in a black wind and dies, but we have hidden in our hearts the flame out of the eyes of Kathleen, the daughter of Houlihan. The wind has bundled up the clouds high over Knocknarea and thrown the thunder on the stones for all that Maeve can say. Angers that are like noisy clouds have set our hearts abeat, but we have all bent low and kissed the quiet feet of Kathleen, the daughter of Houlihan. The yellow pool has overflowed high up on Cluth na Bhur, for the wet winds are blowing out of the clinging air, like heavy flooded waters, our bodies and our blood, but purer than a tall candle before the holy rood is Kathleen, the daughter of Houlihan. Now, if you're Irish and you're reading that and you're going through a hard time, don't you just identify with that? Even though it's not talking about you, it doesn't say, Irish people now are hungry, but do not fear because we have a hunger for individualism in our hearts. You know, it's not saying that, but it's talking about people that maybe they would have known. But we certainly don't know who Kathleen is, or where Cumann Strand is, or who Maeve is, or Knocknarea, but we can still feel that he's acknowledging that, yes, we've been beaten and the wind is trying to blow us over, but we still have that fire. And his point he's making here is that fire is what makes us Irish. And just, I mean, reading this, do you all feel like, you know, someone's trying to light a match inside you? Someone's acknowledging that you've had hardship, but you can do it because your past, your ancestors, the people who lived on this land before you, they did it, so you can too. I mean, it's a battle cry. And it's interesting to note that these are a lot of these early poems we've read, and according to one of these authors from one of these books, let's see, Philip Marcus says that for a revolutionary writer, Yeats' earlier poems contain very little political content. And he understood what I just explained that about Ireland not having a national identity, so he worked to build that up first before they could begin this whole process of trying to get their independence from the British. So that is evident in the poems. I mean, everyone can see that that is a big part of what he wrote about. So I just want to say a few things about you know, how literary revival came about, and I'm not going to bog you down too much with dates and times, but I just want you to get a feel for this whole process that Ireland was going through. So, and I will make it in a way that you can understand by comparing it to the American Revolution. So the Irish literary revival seems to have occurred in backwards order, according to one of these guys. Unlike the American literary renaissance, which occurred years after the American Revolution did, the fight for Irish independence from England happened long after the cultural revival of Ireland. Yeats' work could serve to explain this reversal. So I have a few points here that I'd like to make. So as we've already discussed, Ireland had no real national identity. As we know, what was once a strong sense of culture was lost after years of hardship and colonial subjugation. America, on the other hand, had a strong sense of Americanness before the Revolutionary War. I mean, that was a big part of what we were fighting for, was that we knew what America stood for, and we decided that under the British, we couldn't be that. So we used that to kind of infuse us with the sense of pride for a nation that didn't even exist yet to overthrow our subjugators and to become what we thought we could be. So, and many argue that this was, in fact, how we won the war against a much larger and better equipped opponent, was that sense of American pride, even though America didn't exist yet. So, then Ireland didn't have that. They had the subjugation, but they didn't have that thing, that little gem that gleamed in the heart of every American patriot. You know, they just didn't have that yet. They were too busy trying to get enough potatoes to pay the rent. So I said, in order to gain the strength to revolt, Ireland first had to rediscover what Ireland was. You know, what does it mean to be Irish? And Yeats' poetry really served to kind of stir that up a little bit. So that is the point I was going to make there. And I had some other things that I wanted us to look at, but I know time is kind of getting... Oh, what time is it?
It's 20, but go ahead if it's going to be relatively
okay,
quick.
Yeah, it is going to be fantastic. Mm-hmm. So, let's see. Well, I wanted us to read To Ireland in the Coming Times, because it's a really, really good one. But we can just kind of gloss over that one so we can do the activity, but I really do recommend reading it at one point, because it's just a classic. So, we're on page 18. We're going to go on to our activity now. On page 18, there's two things that really stood out to me. The dedication to a book of stories selected from the Irish novelists, the 1985 version. And then right after it is the same poem, but the 1925 version. And, you know, when you're reading the poems, it really does show, you know, the change that he's had. And I would like to know your opinion, to know what changed, because after the revival really took hold, he kind of got what he wanted, for the most part, from what I can see. And then after this 1925 version, this is after the Civil War, where they were fighting for Irish independence, and it says that he was disillusioned with both the cause of Irish nationalism and prospects for cultural and spiritual renewal in Ireland. So what I'm going to do, which is the best way to compare and contrast something, is I'm going to draw a Venn diagram. Everybody loves Venn diagrams. And everybody's going to come up, and we're going to have one side is the 1895, and one side is the 1925 version, and then we'll have a little space in the middle for the similarities. And I want everyone to just muse for a minute on what makes them different and what makes them similar. I really want to know your opinions. You know, why do you think he had such an idea? And I have a quote from the book to kind of start you off here. You just have to write small. I tried. Those are circles. So this is what, the 1925? And this is it 1895? Is that it?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So just to kind of kick start, this probably should be a little bigger because I do have some poignant similarities. There you go. That's circular in shape. From A Reader's Guide to William Butler Yeats. All right, so this is what he says about these two poems here. He says, even more explicitly autobiographical. He's talking about how his poems can serve as an autobiography about Yeats's life. Yeats's revision of the dedication to a book of stories selected from the Irish novelists turns what had been the patriotic and sentimental tune of the first draft into an indictment of Ireland, I read that country where a man can be so crossed, can be so battered, badgered, and destroyed that he's a loveless man. Yeats' imagery, drawing on the same bell branch that had put Oisin to sleep on his third island, which is drawn from a mythology, a well-known mythology, contrasts Ireland's one-time green boughs with those barren ones of the present. So, you know, I want you to come up 1895 versus 1925 and what happens in the middle. So I want to know what was patriotic and sentimental about the first one, and how does it turn into an indictment of what Ireland has become? If Ireland is fighting for their independence, don't you think that's something he would have wanted? But from reading the second poem, you do see that it is, you know, he doesn't seem satisfied with what's going on. So I would like, you know, compare and contrast, please. Anybody, anytime now, like to come up? And you can come up more than one at a time. There's plenty of room up here. If you need more room, we can fix these circles. Oh, I don't have more chalk, though. I have one piece of chalk. Where all the rest of the chalk is. Here, you can have the real chalk. Sorry. Small chalk. There you go, Katie.
I told you, I brought the wrong book.
Feel free to discuss with your classmates if you need the sounding board. Feel free to talk to me about it, so I would like to see what you think.
This is your exercise. This is. I want to see what the class does here.
You're part of my class.
Stop taking my stuff.
Seriously?
I'm serious. Sorry. That's okay. I'm a little slow.
If you guys need help, remember, this is after he seems to have gotten what he wanted out of Ireland, but you see that the second one is much more negative, and the first one is much more optimistic. So think about that. Think about why. So I will ask. I will call upon you.
Did the war happen between these two?
The footnote says that the revised poem is in the wake of the Civil War.
Sorry.
I really do not understand some of this. And I'm only on the third page.
That's like me and Go Down Moses. I'm on page four.
What? That's what I'm
oh.
saying.
Oh, no.
There's one from Double Cup right now.
Which one is it? Which Faulkner?
Go Down Moses.
Oh, okay. Go Down Moses, I don't. Go Down Moses. I know the Sound and the Fury. And I could probably explain what your problems with that might be, at least in the first
part. It's just for me, like, there's so many people.
And there's a whole, like, on page two or three, there's, like, a whole paragraph, and it's just one sentence, and it's really confusing.
No, so
just skip that. Just keep going.
I mean, in all honesty, though, like, I have just tried to just keep reading. Regardless if I'm confused or not, just read it.
I need to do that.
That's what I'm going through. Right?
I'll do that today.
By the end of this class, Faulkner might make more sense to you.
She's going to have a
What?
She's going to have a
Good job, guys. Keep up the good work. I like what you do. Sorry, I don't have better talk for you.
We'll survive.
And then I got the barren
Daniel, come on. People keep taking your stuff.
I am.
Come up with some similarities. Come on, I like what you said.
Similarities.
Nature references. What else do you see about the both of them? We both talk about Ireland. Say that. They both have the same title. Anything at this point, just to put something in there. But that is important that they do have the exact same title. Same title with completely different feelings.
You're farther than I am. Do you know who Uncle Buddy is?
Yeah. Uncle Buddy.
Uncle Buddy doesn't like to go anywhere.
Right.
Okay. Chalk. All right. Yeah. So I'm
already
in
here.
Hey, Brian. Why not have a circle bigger? I'm so sorry. If you could call it a circle, it looks like an olive.
I don't know. I haven't gotten there yet.
Thank you,
Daniel. I haven't gotten there yet.
For two weeks.
No, I'm going to go for me. You don't have to, as long as it calls on you.
The eight looks pretty good.
It's good.
I was trying to finish out the other day. I ain't worried. I was
smart.
I
know.
Carefully. No, I will have this done because I'm not listening to it.
Oh, guys, there's a whole box of brand new chocolate in here. I'm sorry. Well, you need to sympathize with the Irish and use tiny bits of chalk. As a colonizer, I get all the chalk, and you, a colonist, can just. Oh, God. Seriously, go to the it's right here if you want it. Who hasn't gone? Haven't seen some faces up here? Kermit, have you gone yet? You're not going to. Okay. Do you have it? Well, I'm going to call on you to talk about it, okay? I'm going to call on you to talk about it, though.
Oh, I don't know.
Why so you got to think of something. I know what your name is. I'll come at you. How are we doing on this? Are we doing good?
Try to bring it to a close.
Okay. I feel like I've transmitted most of my ideas without segueing so much into other things that I care about more. All right, has everybody gone? Has everybody gone that doesn't refuse to go? Have you gone? You haven't? Come on, write something. Two arms and two legs. But you can just like write like one word. Write a similarity. What's the same about the two?
Ireland.
Yeah, I know. I have the same title. They're written by the same author.
Hey, I wrote author. You can't steal mine.
I'm sorry. There we go. All right. So while she's finishing up writing, so it's not so super awkward, talk about it. Tell me what you think. Why do you think it's so different? Without receiving any kind of like actual cultural context at all, tell me what's your feeling? Ireland has fought for its freedom, may or may not have won some ground there. So what do you think? While you're thinking about that, we will look at our Venn diagram here, okay? First, we'll look at our similarities. They are pretty similar. Calm of fairy. Who wrote that? You wrote that? Okay, what do you mean? What do you mean by calm of fairy? I like how it sounds. Okay, well, I'll skip you then. Music. Okay, who wrote music? Okay, what do you think, Daniel? What about the music?
Because it talks about bells, they bring laughter and stuff like that.
Okay, so that's some lightheartedness brought in there. And that also is a nod to mythology about there's a branch, a green ball, whatever, and they put bells on it, and it's something to do with mythology. Whose shaking cast all men into a gentle sleep? Per the footnote there. Okay, nature, references, strong land ties. Okay, we see that, and that's again something that we've touched on that's important, we'd all agree. Author, thank you, Katie, for that. Okay, also they have the same title, but would you all agree that they have two very, even though they have the same title and the same theme, they all have very different feelings to them. Would everyone agree to that? Sounds legit, okay. All who heard it dreamed a little while. All right, and then what's the opposite of that? All grew friendly for a little while. Okay, is that you, Courtney?
Yeah.
All right, explain that to me.
I don't know, I guess it just sounded like in the first one it was like it would never happen, like all these things that they wanted and desired, and the thoughts of like Ireland being like flourishing again, kind of.
Yeah.
It's like they dreamed it and they didn't really think it could happen, but then And the second one, they said friendly, which kind of made me think of community and like all the farmers and like people came together to kind of create that flourishment that they were looking for.
Okay, so you're saying that's a successful note here. He is giving a nod to something that they have achieved.
Yeah.
Okay, I like that. All right, next one, green balls. Did it say my bell branch something? Bells ring laughter. Okay, and then who wrote this one? Who can explain this movie?
That was me.
What do you got?
It was the my bell branch hummers and gay bells ring laughter. And the opposite was that he's a loveless man. Gay bells ring laughter.
Okay, so I see what you mean. You're saying that this one was a little more positive.
Yeah.
And that one was loveless man, so not positive. Awesome. Waveworn Irie, I wrote that one. Waveworn, which this one I know I stole it. It was the most obvious one, but my presentation. So, Waveworn Irie, it doesn't sound, I mean, it's obviously not a positive poem and then a negative poem. It shows that there's hopefulness and things, but there is also, you know, Ireland is wave-worn. It's been battered by waves of colonization. It's been battered by famine. It's been battered by, you know, political and social turmoil. So wave-worn, but here, after things, you know, after this time when they've been fighting for progress, or so it would seem, he calls it tragic. So that is certainly something to think about when we start to hear the cultural context after my presentation, is that why is it, you know, waveform here, but then it's tragic here. Why isn't it tragic here? So that's a good one to think about. All right, memories of old village faces. Who wrote that one?
I did. It was just a different feel at the end of each poem because the first one seemed somewhat, optimistic maybe, just
like
more
idyllic.
Positive, because like memories of old village faces. But then at the end of the other one, it's talking about how the memories are half forgotten, and it's more tragic.
Yeah,
it has the different endings.
Okay, good. Let's see, bitterness, not tainting Irish soil. Who wrote that one?
That was me. In the second rendition, even though his tone is obviously a lot different, I mean, he still says, gay bells are sad, they bring you memories. We in our bitterness have left no traces on monster grass and Connemara skies. So despite all they've been through, it's still Ireland, it's still their home.
Okay, perfect, thank you. All right, guys, I appreciate it. Give yourselves a round of applause for participating. Thank you, and that's, and this is going to really set the stage for what we're about to hear next, so enjoy that, right guys?
I have questions.
What? Oh, I forgot to ask for questions. What do you have?
Did y'all grill me on questions?
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. What do you got?
Okay, so, when you were talking about the land does not belong to them, it's giving a legend mythology to a certain place.
Mm-hmm.
Did you mean, is this saying the land belongs to them by giving them the personification that legendary?
That is an excellent question. Yeah, I mean, basically, because people consider their legends, I mean, just the word, their legends. You know, they say, these are my stories passed down from my ancestors, you know, the people that begot me, maybe fought in this war and won this battle. You know what I'm saying? Your legends become a part of you, who you are, a part of your identity. And so by assigning certain geographical locations to these legends, saying that this hilltop is where this fairy queen was buried, this kind of giving the land back to the people after it had been taken away from them and wrestled over during the various wars and unrest. So yeah, I would say yes, it gives it back to the people.
Okay, that answers my second question. Third question. On page 33, the black wind, did you think that that was a reference to the British?
Let me see. 33. I'm not going to put myself out there and say it's a reference to a certain thing. I'm going to stick with my assertion that the wind is that imagery of a force coming to knock them down. You know, I'm not, because it could be anything. It could be the British coming to take away their ideals and assert their own. It's, you know, the famine coming to take away their connection with the land and force them into cities where then they're forced with new hardships like, you know, the poverty, you know, low wages, unable to pay their rent, all the problems that were talked about in Jonathan Swift's A Modest Proposal. I mean, it's a similar thing. So I wouldn't say it necessarily is the British, but I'm saying that it is forces of the world coming to knock the Irish down and test their Irishness.
Last one.
All right. Oh, fantastic. I'm really happy about this.
Okay. On the first 1895 one,
yes,
versus the 1925 one. Okay. The first one is, do you think that it's what he wanted for Ireland? And then the second one, he realized what he got. And so that explains the change of tone.
I wouldn't necessarily say it is all about what he wanted for Ireland, but I do think that he infuses this poem with a sense of optimism for what he believes Ireland can become. And the reason why I chose these two poems, not just because it was convenient, you know, it's in the book, you had to read them, you had to have noticed that it's the exact same poem twice, and it's, you know, a good thing for us to talk about, but I also wanted to use them as a way to show another part of his idea for Ireland, is that, you know, Ireland has been wave-worn, but because of who we were and who we could be, Ireland could be this. You know, it's here, but it could be this. So I don't know if it's necessarily what he wants from Ireland, but I do believe it is a more optimistic version of the reality of Ireland and how he sees it. So any more questions? Courtney, looking at me, okay, have a question? No? Anyone? Do you have any questions? No.
I think I'm good.
You think
Thanks.
You're good? You want me to stop, that's why. Okay.
Let's see.
Well, that is it. That is it for me. Right. So, thank you.
Okay. So actually, could you leave? You just erased something that I actually wanted to leave up.
Well.
So, yes. Here, I'll take care of the rest of it.
Like the potato famine, I have erased part of Ireland's cultural past.
Reason I want to leave up the quotes here that that Courtney chose in particular, and it has to do with why we tend to think of Yeats as a modernist poet. Right? If we look at the poems that you read for today, right there, does there seem to be anything particularly daring or experimental about them? Do they seem to be sort of peculiarly avant-garde in any way? Yeah, I mean, compared to a lot of the other stuff we've been reading and other things that we will read, a lot of what he's writing, at least in his early phase of his career, seems pretty conventionally kind of late romantic / Victorian, right? This is pointing to part of the reason why we tend to group even the early Yeats with what we call sort of high modernists. Right? This "all who heard dreamed a little while" in the 1895 poem versus "all grew friendly for a little while." Now, Courtney was right about the distinction here, right? Particularly when we talk about the second, the 1925 version, right? That this is part of a kind of communal vision. All grew friendly for a little while. Everybody got along for a little while. And wasn't that wonderful? Wasn't that great? But the really, in a lot of ways, more authentically Yeatsian line, and by the way, Yeats was a serial reviser of his poems. Just about every time a new edition of a previous poem was published, he went back and reworked it. So you will find often substantial differences between late versions of Yeats' poems and their earlier counterparts. But in a lot of ways, the 1895 version is more typically Yeatsian. Because dreaming
is a solitary activity. This is the thing that makes Yeats a modernist, right? When we look at modernist literature, what modernists tend to be interested in is internal experience and internal subjectivity, the psychology of the individual as a sort of wellspring of his own inspiration, rather than the values of the community. Right, this is one thing, like there are a lot of people who refer to modernism as an anti-romantic literary strain or anti-romantic ideology. I would call bullshit on that, because they are both looking at inspiration sort of welling up from the same source, really sort of from within the self, right, like a kind of visionary experience. And Yeats, particularly as he gets older, and as he gets more directly political, Mary Catherine was right that there is very little in these early poems that is directly political. But Yeats was certainly very much involved in a kind of cultural politics at this time. Yeats becomes more and more distrustful of groups, particularly of what he would refer to as the mob. His personality and his work as he gets older become increasingly aristocratic in tone. In his original vision, which is primarily a rural vision, he sees society working as essentially sort of two symbiotic halves, right? You have a noble and self-sacrificing aristocracy that works for the good of the people, and happy, vigorous, prosperous peasants who love and respect the aristocracy and know their place in the natural order of things. What Yeats doesn't like, what he really is bothered by, is the rise of an urban commercial merchant class, particularly centered around Dublin. And a lot of his poetry early, and this is one of the consistent lines we see in the whole of Yeats's long career, right? You know, this is a guy who continued writing, you know, he started writing poetry as a very young man and continued writing up to the day he died. He died in his late 70s. So he's extremely prolific. But one consistent strain throughout his career is his contempt for commercialism and for the merchant middle classes whom he regards as sort of really having no culture. Yeah, go ahead.
There was something I read in his relationship with Margon.
Yes.
And she was an extreme activist. And
she was,
nationalism.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And he, there was comments that he did not want to get his art involved in that. So it
yes.
looked like he was, didn't want to play.
And you know,
of course he did.
Yeah, he doesn't want to play as directly as she does. Yeah. Yeats is part, when we talk about this idea of like an Irish literary revival, this is actually a distinct movement in literary history. In the late 19th, early 20th centuries. Yeats is probably the prime mover in this particular group. There are other groups he's involved in with in which he's not the prime mover. We'll talk about those in a second. But the Irish literary revival is probably more important to our purposes, so we'll start there. So in addition to Yeats, there's a group of writers that we talk about when we discuss this revival are Yeats' friend and patron, Lady Gregory, the folklorist, poet, and playwright Douglas Hyde, the playwright J.M. Singh, the novelist George Moore, the minor playwright Edward Martin, and the poet, painter, and mystic visionary George Russell, who went by the pseudonym A.E., short for Eon, because mysticism.
Ooh.
So, what do you notice about these names? Yeats, Gregory, Hyde, Singh, Russell. How Irish do most of these names sound?
Nobody's named like
McDougal
or...
No, no, there's no Mick or O anything here, right? Yeah,
are
most of these
Anglo-Irish?
Writers... Pardon?
Oh, I said are they Anglo-Irish?
They are mostly, with the exception of Moore and Martin, Anglo-Irish. Moore and Martin are the only Catholics in the group, and their descent actually comes from a group known as the Old English. That is, those English who came over in the 12th century when Norman knights came into Ireland to pacify it. Right? There have been English people in Ireland at least, there's been an English presence in Ireland at least since the 12th century. So they're from that particular line of people. Anybody whose last name starts with Fitz is also among the Old English. Fitz is actually a Norman prefix. So the Old English, unlike those English and Scots who came into Ireland in the 16th century, tended to be Catholic. But yeah, the rest of these writers are Anglo-Irish Protestants, so they belong to the same broad social group as Wilde and Shaw. Now, religion and culture are sticking points that get between the Anglo-Irish and native Catholic Irish, those who sort of think of themselves as Celtic Irish. In particular, Protestant religion is an issue. So what a lot of these writers are trying to do, Yeats in particular, and Douglas Hyde, they're looking to folk culture to try to excavate a pre-Christian Irish culture, a pre-Christian Irish ideal, right? Something that existed before any particular strain of Christianity came to Ireland, something that is thus sort of authentically Irish in spirit. And this is one of the reasons why Yeats is so focused on mythology. This is why he's bringing all of these Irish heroes and Irish gods into his poems. It's part of, you know, we call this cultural nationalism.
Yeah, well, Christianity was kind of taken away from him and his family.
Oh, yeah.
And he was looking for something to hold on to with all of his...
Sure.
You know, his interest in the occult.
Yeah, this is one angle of that. Yeah, exactly. This is one of the things that he clings to as a sort of quest for meaning in religion. And the other is sort of, as you were noting there as well, a kind of batshit loonball occultism, which we will talk a little bit more about in a couple of weeks. Because while it is kind of nutty, and most of the things that Yeats believed in that realm, no one else actually believed, it's very idiosyncratic. It is also very important to understanding the system that animates much of his later work. So, this is the Irish context in which Yeats is operating, right? He's one of this group of Anglo-Irish writers who are looking backward, or looking at sort of peasant or folk cultures, and reinventing Irish mythology and inventing this kind of ideal of the Irish peasants in order to strike back against English colonialist stereotypes. Just to give you some sense of what those stereotypes were like. Right, a I'm going to show you first a cartoon from an English magazine which depicts sort of the way your typical English humorist of the late Victorian era imagined Africans. Okay, so what we see here is a sort of what's supposed to be a comparative cartoon, right? It says Crystal Palace, some varieties of the human race. And we have two well-dressed, sophisticated ladies, right, covered up to their, you know, from their chins down to their down to below their ankles, sipping tea at a table quietly, and behind them we have a group of Africans. They're naked, they're carrying weapons and shields. We see, you know, their features are exaggerated. Large noses, large lips. They're fighting. Now I'm gonna switch over to a couple of cartoons that portray Irish stereotypes from the same time. Here we have the rebellious Irishman sitting on top of a lit barrel full of gunpowder, surrounded by his wife and children. Do we notice a similarity in the way this guy's depicted? What's the stereotype? What's the common thread between the stereotypes here?
Exaggerated features.
Okay, we have the exaggerated, kind of animalistic features. Pardon?
Kind of like some othering, almost.
Yeah, exactly. This is someone who is not supposed to be an Englishman, right? Clearly, he's supposed to be marked as different from the Englishman, willing to blow himself and his whole family up to get what he wants. Pardon?
In regards to human life.
Yeah. Obstinate, right? Stubborn, violent. Now here we see another from the same era, right? We have the fat ape-like Paddy, right? Wearing a sort of leprechaun-y hat with the pipe in it. He has simian features. He's fat. He's armed with a cane and a knife. And he's dancing on top of all of these products of empire. He's got corn, drugs, potatoes, pork, coffee, flour, right? This is one of those kind of, like, remember we talked a little bit about sort of like the Little England idea? We talked about Heart of Darkness, that there were some anti-imperialists who were anti-imperialist because they felt that imperialism was a drag on the English economy. This is coming from that same strain of thought. Right, that the Irish are a bunch of spongers, and that's why we should cut them loose. So, what the revival writers and artists are trying to do is provide a sort of corrective to this negative stereotype. Right, England as the colonial center often defined the colonial others as these kind of sort of animals or children that simply didn't know how to look after themselves. And what the revivalists are trying to do is portray a kind of, you know, rich heritage that existed before English rule. Now, much of this rich heritage that they come up with is purely imaginary. Even the idea that Ireland existed as a unified nation in the distant past is a historical fiction, right? It was typically, the island was comprised of at least four different kingdoms, sometimes five, that warred with each other as often as they fought against outsiders. Now, the other significant context here is a specifically English one. Yeats was, Yeats spent good portions of his childhood in Dublin and in County Sligo in the west of Ireland. So he did have some direct knowledge of rural Irish life. But he also spent a good portion of his formative years in London. His father was a minor painter of the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, which I think we talked a little bit about. We talked about these painters like Dante Gabriel Rossetti and William Holman Hunt, who painted these sort of medievalized, stylized paintings. They're sort of loosely associated with decadence. And this is the other sort of place where Yeats fits in, at least in the 1880s and 1890s. He's part of another group in which he's not the central figure, based in London, called the Rhymers Club. The Rhymers Club met in a pub in Fleet Street in London called the Cheshire Cheese in the Upper Room. It was also the favorite haunt of the 18th century writer Samuel Johnson. So it had that kind of historical association they liked. And they were kind of, in a lot of ways, deliberately old-fashioned. They went up there and smoked clay pipes, for example. And other writers in this group would have included the poets, Lionel Johnson, John Davidson, Ernest Dowson, Ernest Rhys, Richard Le Gallienne, Selwyn Image, which is a great name, and scour the internet for pictures of Selwyn Image, you will not find one. No image exists of Selwyn Image.
Did he exist?
Oh, he did. Yeah, he was a real person. And that was his real name.
It's in hiding.
Yes. Image obscured.
Would this have been like a precursor to the Algonquin Round Table?
Probably no direct relation, but these kinds of groups...
The same thing.
These kinds of groups were common, yeah. And often, like, the Rhymers never really did. They actually did publish a book together that collected the verse of several members. It was called the Book of the Rhymers Club. And then there was the creatively titled Second Book of the Rhymers Club. But, yeah, what these guys had in common was a kind of decadent aesthetic, right? They all knew Oscar Wilde. Wilde wasn't a member of the group, but he would sometimes come to their meetings and would read with them. And Wilde, in fact, had shown young Yeats a bit of kindness, right? He knew that Yeats was a fellow Irishman, young guy. It's like he assumed wrongly that Yeats was alone in London for Christmas, and so invited him to Christmas dinner with his family. And so they sort of sat together and, you know, Wilde read to Yeats some of his new work that no one else had heard yet. So Wilde is actually a pretty big early influence on Yeats. In particular, this is one thing that Yeats gets from Wilde that becomes a very important modernist idea. The idea of the mask. Right, that the artist is not necessarily interesting in and of himself. What's really interesting about the artist is the different personae that a gifted artist can adopt, can speak through, the different masks that an artist can put on. Right, we see this in the picture of Dorian Gray, right, in the Sybil Vane subplot, right? That Sybil Vane is only interesting to Dorian Gray when she's playing a role, when she's playing a part. So, right, Sybil Vane is kind of the embodiment in that novel of Wilde's doctrine of the mask. Right, we see here there's a poem, in fact, called The Mask. if somebody else has the page number, right, page 39. Put off that mask of burning gold with emerald eyes. Oh no, my dear, you make so bold to find if hearts be wild and wise and yet not cold. I would but find what's there to find, love or deceit. It was the mask engaged your mind and after set your heart to beat, not what's behind. But lest you are my enemy, I must inquire. Oh no, my dear, let all that be. What matters so there is but fire in you, in me? So this is a conversation between a pair of lovers, one of whom is asking to see behind the artist figure's mask, while the artist figure puts off the request, right? No, you don't want to see what's behind my mask. What engaged your mind, what engaged your attention is, in fact, the false face that I'm wearing. That's what interests you. It doesn't matter what I'm wearing behind it or what I am behind it. What matters is the face I present to you, the persona I present to you. And an artist should be able, according to both Wilde and Yeats, to adopt any one of a variety of different masks. Some of this actually comes out of Yeats's occult studies, which he did begin. We're not going to talk about those until we talk about his sort of mid-period poetry, but he began them fairly early, and the path he was assigned by his occult superiors was Hodos Chameleontis, the path of the chameleon, the path of transformation. So, we're running out of time, but I want to finish up here by looking a little bit more specifically at certain things that speak to Yeats's artistic interest in this period. Now, Mary Catherine referenced in Red Hanrahan's Song About Ireland, Kathleen, the daughter of Houlihan. Does anybody know who or what Kathleen O'Houlihan is, or what you call the tradition of Irish poetry that she comes from?
Wasn't she like part of the Fae that drowned herself?
Pardon?
Wasn't she part of the Fae that drowned herself?
Oh, that's the Clooth na Bear, yes. That's.
I remember the footnotes.
Mm-hmm. It's okay if you don't know this. Kathleen the daughter of Houlihan, is a sort of idealized figure for Ireland. Who comes out of a 17th and 18th century poetic tradition called Aisling. A-I-S-L-I-N-G. Spelled Aisling, pronounced Aisling. Now, in the Aisling poem, right, usually the poet falls asleep and is visited in his dreams by a kind of vampire woman who offers to make him great, but he has to sacrifice his youth and vitality to her to keep her beautiful. Right, it's a similar sort of figure to what we see. Like, how many of you know the Keats poem, La Belle Dame Sans Merci? Okay, that's not encouraging. But okay. But yeah, these this kind of, you know, vampire woman who steals the youth of her lovers, right? So the Aisling woman is a kind of destructive muse.
Is he drawing a parallel there by calling the woman he was in love with who married someone else, mm-hmm. and then he wrote like three poems in 5 years, he's saying that she is the destructive muse?
This is very much related to Yeats's long unrequited love for Maud Gunn, yes. He proposed to Gunn 4 times over the course of their lives. When he failed with her, he tried to propose to her daughter. Right after the 4th failure. Now, Maud Gunn is exactly this, like when you look at poems like No Second Troy or Woman Homer's Song, right, he's talking about like this kind of destructive power of the beautiful woman, right? He describes this in some places as, the daughter of Herodias dancing with the poet's severed head. Right, that she's a wellspring of inspiration, but she is also destructive to the life and happiness of the poet. You can tell he's talking about Gunn if there are apple blossoms referenced in the poem. It's one of his earliest memories of her is her sort of standing on among the apple blossoms. And I think, the identification with Gunn and the Aisling figure is a good one because Yeats and Gregory co-wrote a play together called Kathleen Houlihan, in which a bent and wrinkled old woman walks into a peasant cabin, talks about her 4 beautiful green fields that have been stolen by the strangers in her house, and entrances the young man about to be married who lives there and leads him off to fight the English, probably to his death. Now, does anybody know, or can anybody guess, who the actress who played the lead part in that play was when it premiered?
Maud Gunn?
Yes, very good, Mary Catherine, yes.
Yes.
So yeah, he definitely associates her with this particular figure. All right, does anybody have any questions about anything? Okay, so I'm gonna give you some reading questions for next time. And look, Needleloy is a head trip, right? Now, what makes Yeats difficult is maybe not understanding some of the references he's making. What Needleloy is doing is sort of genuinely experimental and avant-garde. So I hope that these questions help you. But yeah, I just know that, the reading is brief, but it's not going to be easy.